they have an impact. And inshallah ta'ala, we are blessed in this city, the coldest city, a city that people would never have imagined that we'd have shuyukh like Sheikh Mahmoud and great scholars of this likeness here in our city. We're very fortunate to have that. Inshallah, without any further delay, I will pass the microphone. Barakallahu feek ya Sayyidi.
Allahumma jazakallah khair. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulillah. الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك. أنت المقدم وأنت المؤخر وأنت على كل شيء قدير. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most compassionate, the most merciful, all praise and thanks are due to Him and peace and blessings be upon His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He who is guided by the will of Allah, no one can misguide him. And he who is misguided, no one can guide him except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I do bear witness that there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is His messenger. Respected sisters and brothers, as I always must start my talk with, من لا يشكر الناس لا يشكر الله. The one who does not say thanks to the people, he's not thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jazakumullah khair jaza for this amazing warm welcoming by every single person of this beautiful city, by the masjid, by the community, by the brothers and sisters, the families, mashallah. It's my first time in Canada in general and my first time in Edmonton. I really enjoyed visiting this city. Thank you very much for every single person for showing this kind of beautiful attitude, kind of everything beautiful that I can say. Jazakumullah khair. And I hope inshallah Allah will enable me in the recent future inshallah to be with you again. Allahumma ameen. But maybe those who maybe followed some of the titles, we were supposed to talk about the title then. I received a request to tackle something that could be much more important. The title that I was asked to talk about is how to be a positive contributor to your community. So I was told that which is a problem wherever you go. It's not just a specific problem in a specific community. We have a serious problem that some great people, Allah has given them a lot of beautiful things, powerful things. It does not come to their mind that there is a duty upon their shoulders what to do and that they must do something. So this is our topic today, so that we might bring together all kind of powers for the sake of supporting the haqq and the khair in this dunya with the Mawla Azza wa Jalla. Now, how to be a positive contributor to your community. My first message. In many cases, maybe you have noticed me, sometimes when I ask to talk about the how, I start with the why. The talk is about how, but the start is with why gives you the motivation. Why gives you the power? I just, 1 hour ago, I was talking about something has to do how to raise children, okay? How to tackle problems with children. The question was how. I told the brothers and sisters there, just 1 hour ago, I told them the same thing. I have to start with the why before the how. And I gave an example about the why and the how. Now, the atheist, the one who denies, the one who rejects completely the possibility of existence of Allah, God forbid, when he rejects Allah, rejects the existence of Allah, and he rejects completely the unseen, consequently, he will be in the following status. If he asked himself, why not to lie? Why not? Why not to steal? Why not to kill? Why not to attack? Why not to give bribe? Why not? Indirectly, as if he will be the God of himself, what his mind tells him will be justified because it's just him. Because atheists, if he's a genuine atheist, okay, he should be believing in the following. He believes that we came under the law of coincidence, صدفة, by Mother Nature. There is no divine will, no creator, nothing as such. So just I'm part of the coincidence, just من الصدفة. And we will finish at a certain time, and there is nothing such as metaphysics or الغيب or ما وراء الطبيعة. If I'm with this person, okay, I could be doing anything. No one can stop me by saying you should not do this. Why? There is no. By the way, there is no place for why. Because everything is just coincidence, and that's it. I do what comes to my mind. I'm trying to tell you how dangerous the question of why is. For us, why we are here? Because Allah created us, and His will is telling us that وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. The meaning of the ibadah, انقيادٌ وخضوعٌ تامٌ دون أدنى شرط, full submission without any kind of preconditions in every single aspect in my life. طيب, why I'm not supposed? Because Allah wants so. Okay? طيب, why Allah has prohibited alcohol? Because it kills the place of what gives you the dignity as a human being. We say in the language of Islamic jurisprudence, manatu taklif, which means the thing that because of it, you became a mukallaf, responsible, mature, and you could be achieving something above angels. And if you lose it, you might be below animals, which is al-aql, reason. Okay? Now, the why, it's part of our faith. Allah created us, therefore I do. Why, it's always there. We have justification, we have reasoning, it's very clear. You can exactly understand, put the justifications and etc. So therefore, when I say, for example, how to be, I'm asking before it, why? Why gives you the justification, the power and the motivation? Clear? Now part of the why, at least to the best of my knowledge, let's do it at least in my way, okay? I'm not saying this is the best way, but this is my way. How to justify the why. How to give you the power of why you must be a positive contributor to your community, okay? I always do this test. I did it at least maybe 100 or 150 times in my life. And I did it with around maybe 35,000 people since 15 years. And I will repeat it with you. And I'm expecting 99.9% you will fall in the test. Which is, and I will prove it to you now. I will say a verse from Quran. And I will stop by a certain word. I want you to continue the verse, okay? But very quickly, without thinking. Just to see how many of you memorize the verse. Very quickly. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وقعت بالفخ. Why you did not say لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا ما أتاها? More common, طبعا. This is the problem. We have two verses in the Quran. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. And we have another verse. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا ما أتاها. Most of us, we memorize by default. It comes immediately. إلا وسعها. Now, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها was revealed to give you the satisfaction and to give you the excuse when you cannot do something. It's like, okay, ويا الله ولا بس okay, don't worry. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Don't worry. طيب. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا ما أتاها. It means Allah has given you something and He will put you to accountability according to what He has given you. يعني أنت محاسب على ما أوتيت. Got my point? Which means now if you want really to be serious with Allah and with our religion, the ayah that always must come to our mind, which one? إلا ما أتاها. This is the beginning. Which means, oh my God, لا يكلف الله نفس إلا ما أتاها. طيب, Allah will not put me to account to me unless what He has already given me. طيب, what did He give me? This is the question. Let's open the book now. Please, every one of you, let's count. What did he give you? Money, health, wealth, family, language, prestige, knowledge, friends. All of these things will be part of your accountability. You can't count them. You can't count. So Allah is telling us in a rhetorical way, طريقة بلاغية, it has some certain messages by be careful. You will set accountability for what I have given you. Something that you were not given, don't worry. But let's discuss what you have. Got my point? This is my start. Why to be positive? Because Allah has given you and there is accountability. I'm not talking about money. Be careful. I'm not discussing money now. I'm discussing power, discussing personality. Talk about amazing, by the way. Maybe we can count 10 common things between us, but we have another 20 uncommon private things. For example, Mr. X. Mr. X has an amazing social relations with thousands of people. In a few minutes through the social media, he can bring hundreds of people to support a cause of something. I do not have it. So your power, if there is a problem, someone who is in need for the people to take care of something, you have to use your power through, say, wallahi, I don't have a time. No. It's a duty now. You must do it. Because this is your power. This is what Allah has given you. It's not just because you are a nice, handsome person. It's part of the accountability. Allah gave you this share of tests. You know thousands of people and they love you. This is your power. This is your money. This is your rizq. Okay? Use this power in the cause of haqq. طيب, Mr. Y, Mr. B, Mr. I, Mr. whatever. Other person. He's expert in technology, for example. Okay? Third, like one of the things that I used to tell the students of the university, one of the common examples. I said, I'm talking about Jordan now. At Jordan, one of the most difficult, horrible exams is the exams of the, we say the high school, or the tawjihi, we say it, okay? The third secondary, or the second secondary, which is the end of the school. It is really a very scary test in Jordan. Some people, the families, they are in panic for 1 or 2 years when their kids are about to sit for this tawjihi exam. Now, one of the things that is very common in Jordan, the private lessons. As example, private lessons especially for mathematics, physics, and English. These two. Can you imagine that few days before the final test, some private tutors, they ask for 1 hour, 50 JDs, which is 100 for per hour, just 1 hour of reviewing, okay, the material with you, nearly $100. Now, the average of income for Jordanians, it's around 400 JDs, okay, or 450, which is less than $900. So imagine someone who needs 10 or 15 or 20 hours in physics, mathematics, and English, he needs 20 lessons, he needs 2,000. The whole salary of the family might be just 900. What do you think? Well, by the way, thousands of people like this, can they afford it? No, right. Where the solving the problem should come? How many thousands of students who are doing their BA in mathematics, BA in engineering, BA in chemistry, they have done it already, they are enrolled in universities. Go and pay the zakah of your time and your knowledge, Mr. BA students. Go and be a volunteer in your area. Okay? This is your power. You don't have money. You can't pay, but you can give time from your time. Announce in your area, in your building, in your shari, in your street, that I will be giving free for the sake of Allah, between you and Allah. You have, this is the power of you. This is your contributor. I don't have money. Who's asking you for money? I'm asking you for your knowledge and your time. So do the zakah with knowledge and time. For example, type, all of us now, if we have a legal problem in this masjid, whom we need? A lawyer. If there are just two persons who are experts in the legal issues. And they say, well, you know, it's my, I want to take a rest. Be careful, you are the only one who can solve the problem. It's a duty, it's fard ayn alayk now. You must help. Don't let them come and beg you. You come and pay the zakah of your knowledge. You know the law, I don't know it. Okay? They will deceive me, I will be misled. But you will not. You can't prevent, you can't, you know, protect me from this. So this is how we should understand the meaning of لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا ما آتاه. Okay? This is the first message. I'm giving you the justification, logical justification, الدليل from the Quran why we, you, I must be positive contributors to our community. Okay? Now, as always we say, or at least I say it, you know, there's a very famous saying, which means every sheikh has his own way how to deliver a message, which means every person has his own way how to deliver his message. In my way, I would love to use the second methodology, how to push you to be a positive contributor, and push myself as well. I'm with you, by the way. I'm addressing myself as well. Second way. I will be quoting a Quranic verse. This verse, I consider it personally one of the most powerful, provocative verse in the Quran. يعني أكثر آية تستفز الإنسان للحركة والعمل in the context that I'm talking about. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. إن الذين كفروا ينفقون أموالهم ليصدوا عن سبيل الله. This is very well known verse. What is the rest of the ayah? فسينفقونها ثم تكون عليهم حسرة. Most of us, we stick to the second part of the verse, which is الحمد لله فسينفقونها ثم تكون عليهم حسرة. Said, wait. Go to the beginning of the verse, أول شيء. إن الذين those who reject faith, those who rejected Allah and Imam, ينفقون مضارع present sense of they do, they are paying and they do pay all the time. Okay, أموالهم their own money, not the others, which means as if an indication, Mr. Believer. Is it difficult for you to pay? Wallahi, yes. Why? Because, you know, it's my money. It's his money. But you believe in the Akhirah. He does not believe in the Akhirah. How come he does not believe in the Akhirah and he's paying from his money and you don't pay? Wow. Wow. Those who reject faith, those who reject Allah, those who reject Imam, yunfiquna, continuously paying. Paying, what's the purpose? لِيَصُدُّوا عَن سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Their goal, ultimate goal, to, you know, to remove away everyone from the path of Allah. Ya Rabbi, do you need much more clearer ayah than this? Allah is stating, he's telling us, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا يُنْفِقُونَ. They are paying all the time to get the way out from the path of Allah. Wallahi, Anna, when I read this, when I realized this verse, you know, it's like what we call the qash'arira. شو بالإنجليزي qash'arira? ما بعرف أصلاً.
Goosebumps.
مش فاهمها بس هي اللي حكاها. Okay. صعب عيدة تضحك علي يسا. شو بك الشيخ بعرف شيخ إنجليزي يسا. You know, ويا الله. The question is, do you accept that the rejecter of faith who does not accept the Akhirah, who does not believe in Allah, has more powerful cause and motivation to pay for his cause more than you, Mr. Believer? Do you accept it? I should not. Because it's amazing, by the way. I'm the one who should be very generous and in fact, because I believe, in theory, that the money belongs to Allah. And the rizq is from Allah. I myself belong to Allah. And there's an akhirah, I will be rewarded. طب, Mr. Non-believer, he believes in what? He is the God of himself. He came by the law of coincidence. The money is his, the power is his, and he should be pleasuring and enjoying himself. طب when he pays generously under the cause of Allah, مش إشي بجنن. هاي ما بتترجم هاي. لا مش إشي بجنن هاي. كيف تترجمها؟ والله what I call it, I am استفزه. It provokes you. Hey, hey, look, look, look. If he's doing so, you must be better 10 times than him. I'm giving the justification why should I be positive. Because sometimes, يا عمي حط راسك بين الروس وقول يا قطع الروس. يا عمي go to sleep. بدي بالمشاكل. يعني أنا ما قصني. يا عمي, you have to go. You have to contribute. You have to be part of your community. Because if you do not participate, you know, at a certain time, badness, evilness will reach you. If it does not reach you now, it will come later. So this is by the common sense. But Islamically, it's highly justified. You must contribute. You must not stop. Okay? This is the justification. A third way before getting into... And by the way, I think at least you start to have an idea about my way. When I am asked to talk about the how, maybe I spend 5% of the time on the how. Because the how is so easy. It's so easy, the how. You can find tens of ways. No need. I'm giving examples. We can't say it. Okay, how to be positive. Please do such one, two, three. When they need something, be with them. When they have janazah, go with them. When they need money, donate. When they... خلاص. Lecture is finished. What is more serious is why? The power, motivation. Why you are not supposed to go to sleep at home and to have the peace of mind? No peace of mind. You have no right to have peace of mind sleeping at home if there is a need to be supported for the cause of Allah. This is the problem. When I don't have this kind of feel of guilt that who cares, this is a disaster. This is the seeds of our destruction. If still you have this kind of live motivation, no problem with the how. With just little amount of sincerity, Allah will show you. Don't worry. The people will help you. Don't worry. Tens of ways. So I will focus most of my talk on how not to leave this place before being completely, not just convinced. By the way, to be convinced sometimes could be easy. But to have the spiritual motivation and the power to stay with you all the time is the problem. I will prove it to you. How many people they are convinced that smoking is bad? They are convinced logically. Can they leave it? They are not. Is it a matter of conviction? They know for sure. Wallahi, they can give you lectures how bad smoking is on health. Will cancer of lung, cancer of mug, it's just gum, mug, cancer of gum, هاي بكون سامحونا فيها احنا. You know, the different cancers of the gum and the throat and the lung, كله من التدخين يعني, we know this. So medically we are convinced it's a disaster. Logically it is. طيب leave smoking, stop smoking. والله I can't. طيب ليش؟ يقول لك I'm weak, I'm not able to do it. I need the push. Okay? Here comes the serious need. You need this very, very powerful motivation to stop something or to do something. At least in our case, alhamdulillah, we are not addressing atheists. We are not addressing, no. Alhamdulillah, we believe and we know and we must be convinced that why we are not moving. That's why we need a provocative attitude just to keep, it's like, you know, like the thorn in your side. When you, my aim is, I ask Allah to let me, the reason that none of you will feel comfortable when asleep until he does his duty. When you do your duty, go and sleep. Otherwise, there's a problem. But by the way, by this, Islam will be saved. By this, khair will be spread. By this, problem will be solved بإذن مولى عز وجل. I will give you another example. This story I read about one of the businessmen from one of the Gulf states. He was in Germany for some kind of, I forgot in the story, it was a business or for medical, some kind of medical needs, you know, medical treatments. Anyway, he was alone without his family. He hired an apartment. While he's in an apartment, by the way, and I forgot that I must speak in Arabic. Is it okay? Because all the day I was speaking in English, I forgot completely, and I'm sorry. خلاص continue, huh? أنا هلا بخربط بعدين قال بخربط بدي بحكي بالعربي تغير عليك شيطان. So in Germany he was there in his apartment. The someone knocked the door. He was alone in small apartment and it seems he's a religious businessman. He looked from this, what do you call this small, we call it the magic eye in Jordan. العين السحرية بنحكي لها. I don't know. What do you call it here?
Peephole.
Peephole. Ah, okay. So he looked from the peephole. It was a lady, a fair hair, nice, beautiful German lady outside the door. Okay. He does not know what she wants. But he felt embarrassed if he opened the door for whatever reason. She wanted to discuss with him if he came into the apartment. He's alone. He was afraid from the concept of khalwa. Which, I mean, okay, he knows that, so he did not respond. Kept, okay, from outside door. Yes, okay, I want to talk with you. He said, I'm not interested. No, I want to talk with you. I'm not interested. You know, in the West, this is, should be respected. Khalas, I'm not interested. You should leave me. She insisted. When she insisted, he found himself obliged to explain to her that he's a Muslim and his tradition, he's not allowed, it's haram for him to welcome a woman and to stay alone inside the apartment, which is called khalwa. You know this. If you are not allowed to have a, if she's not your wife or your daughter or your mother, we call it amra al-ajnabiyya, which means anyone outside, you know, the area of a wife, mother, daughter, sister, aunt, but paternal, maternal, you are not allowed to be together inside the house with a closed. So it's called khalwa, it's haram. So he want to maintain and to observe his Islamic rulings. So he said, please excuse me, I can't let you get in because it's not allowed in my religion. So please, just ruhi, go away. She insisted, I want to talk with you. Ya ammi, I'm not interested. I want to speak with you. She was as if she was forcing him that by force I will speak with you. JazakAllah khair. Thank you very much. Barakallah khair. JazakAllah khair. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, when I found her insisting and not listening to me, I just ignored her. Then I started continuing what I was doing. I was cooking, I was whatever. When she knew that he will not open the door, you know what she did? She slowed down to the area where they have this kind of, the area of the key or something, at least some kind of a little bit open space where her sound will be much more clear. And for 15 minutes, she kept on calling him to her, let's say, sect. She's from Jehovah's Witnesses. You know Jehovah's Witnesses? Amazing. I mean, they do not accept no as an answer. They don't stop. You can't tell them, excuse me, I'm not interested. You know them? Okay, Jehovah's Witnesses. Now my point is, look, let's deal with this from psychological point of view, from emotional point of view. Generally speaking, when a man and a woman, if someone is interested, who is chasing who? Generally speaking. The men, they always follow when they want to have love or to have a girlfriend or to speak with something. It's not the woman who keep following. The woman, she keeps her dignity and the man is the one who, okay, look after, follows, hey, nice, I love you, I would like to talk with you, hey, whatever, you know, playing with the guitar, you know, sending something, whatever. And it does not hurt our dignity by default. which means it's by nature we have no problem to follow if we want. I'm not talking about haram and halal now. I'm discussing from a human point of view, okay? So look now, she's a woman and he's a man. She's insisting as a female to talk, he's refusing. Who should be hurt psychologically now? Psychologically speaking. But plus, he's an Arab Muslim and she's a German. Who looks at himself as better, generally speaking? Okay? So, two different obstacles. She's a woman, she's a German, she's a Westerner, he's an Arab, a Muslim, a man. This is an old story. Now, psychologically speaking, she should have no motivation, no power to throw herself in front of him, begging him to speak with him, because he refused. Humanly speaking, if I were here from human point of view, I can't have the power because he hurted me. He said, I don't want to speak with you. And he's a man and I'm a woman. You know, for many psychological reasons, خلاص, I should stop. Did that stop her from fulfilling her duty in what she believes? No. Wow. Is there obstacles in her face? Psychological. Yes. Social. Yes. From racism point of view. Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Can't she justify for herself not to continue? Yani if she said, ya ammi, he's insulting me when I'm a woman, I'm not supposed to throw myself in this way, no one will blame her. Did she stop? No. So my question is, who's supposed to put this effort? Someone like this woman or someone who believes in what you believe? Got to my point? And by the way, you can find many examples, but my point is, I must, because I believe, the most important thing, just to fix something inside my heart, inside my mind all the time, I must be a positive contributor. I did not notice the time when I started. How many minutes still I have? When is Sheikh? And Sheikh Bob? 10? 5. Okay. Now, I will finish this simple example with as a methodology on the how. Methodology on the how. Not necessarily, because I gave you examples, but now I will sum up, I will conclude everything through this how example. But this how example contains an amazing message. One of my students at the university, she told me that her brother knows one of his friends who witnessed the following story or incident. I forget the name of the country. It's one of the East European countries, but it's not in my mind now. Okay? East European countries. This friend of the brother of my student, he was visiting this country in a taxi. Now, in the taxi, he noticed a very old car, and the driver is very old man, high aged, maybe 70s, 80s, very old car, and on the back glass or the screen of the car, it is written in the language of that country something like, if you want to know something about Islam, please stop me. So this Arab guy, he was very interested. I mean, why? What is, who's this person? Why is he writing this? And the car is very old and the man is very old. There is something. So he asked the taxi driver just to wave for him and to stop him. He came, okay, you're right, if you want to know about Islam, what's the point? Look what happened now, amazingly. This man from this country, he's not a da'iya, he's not a professional. He does not have money, he does not have any kind of skills of negotiations, and he can't speak about Islam, by the way. But look what he did. You know the trunk of the car, he divided the trunk of the car into spaces like boxes, okay? And he visited all embassies in his country which belong to Muslim countries. He went to the, for example, the embassy of Saudi Arabia, the embassy of Kuwait, the embassy of UAE, the embassy of Jordan, of Palestine, of Pakistan, of Malaysia. Hello, yes, do you have any pamphlets? Do you have any kind of flyers that explain anything about Islam? Any of the embassies in their languages have something? He took it for free and he put it inside these small boxes, 18, 20, 26 languages. Introduction to Islam in different languages from the embassies. So if someone stopped him in the street, the only thing he tries to do is try to guess what kind of language he's speaking. You know, it's not complicated. Sometimes maybe just one word, where are you from? Russia. Oh, Russia, Russia, Spaniola, Italiano, Barre, Harro, Harre, Spaniola, whatever you do, you can, يعني بالمشيها, you can pick it, I mean somehow, Germany, whatever, okay. So it's divided by names. Just pick from Russia. Tfaddal. This is read about my original Russia. Assalamu alaikum. And he continues in his way. La ilaha illallah. But is he professional? No. Does he have the power? No. Knowledge? No. Means? No. Good car? No. Good relations? No. Yeah, I mean, very old car. He's at the end of his time of living. But look, sincerity with the ikhlas, with the least. But I have ham, I have a big goal. I want to do it. Allah guided him to this simple solution. But this simple solution might have caused maybe tens of people to be Muslims and no one knows them, even he himself. But he will discover them when? The Day of Judgment. This is, I need just this example on the methodology of how. This is a creative way. How did it come to his mind? Allah. طب, is it possible that, oh, طبعا, just keep the idea in yourself. Keep making the dua every time you pray. Ya Allah, help me to support the cause of khair in this religion. Just ask Allah. Sometimes Allah will guide you to something did not come to your mind. Speak about this. Ask your close friend. Discuss the issue. Try to search. You will find amazing, amazing ways with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, no need to discuss the how more than simple examples. But the importance is what? Why? I hope, with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that none of us will leave this place but having this kind of powerful motivation, inshallah. That whenever Islam, whenever goodness, whenever khair is in need for me, I'm ready. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help all of you to be from those people, inshallah, who will be able to raise up their heads proudly when they stand before their Lord in the Day of Judgment, saying, Ya Allah, Alhamdulillah, I've done my best. Ya Allah, with your tawfiq, Allahumma, forgive me and you will do the best. And every one of us can do it with the Mawla Azza wa Jal. Now at the end, this is the end of my talk and end my visit and the end of my, let's say, tour here in Edmonton. Thank you very much for being excellent listeners. Barakallah fikum. Don't forget me in my dua. And by the way, when I say don't forget me, I remember the joke happened with me 28 years ago. Let me finish with it. I was doing my master's degree at that time, master's degree in Jordan, in Tafsir. So my English, you know, the level of English, it's very simple, very humble, just governmental school, public schools, which is yani, very humble. I received an invitation to attend like a special youth conference in Budapest, Hungary. I was the weakest person in my English out of 125 persons. I think, no, second weakest. The weakest was from Russia. So now, when I was about to leave the place, it's a conference, youth conference. So I wanted to thank them. You know, I was thinking in Arabic. You know, I think in Arabic and I translate. So in Arabic, we say الرجاء سامحوني. فبنحكي الرجاء ما تنسوني في دعائكم. So it should be translated, please don't forget me in your prayers. So because it was my first time that I stand, I think it's my first time in my life that I stand, you know, before a group of people speaking English 28 years ago. I was hardly able to speak in Arabic. So what about English? So because, you know, the horrible situation and I'm facing people from all different cultures and religions, we were representative of all religions on earth. It was, you know, very difficult situation. So I wanted to say, please don't forget me in your prayers. So I closed my eyes so not to make a mistake. I said, please don't forgive me. Please don't forgive me. Please don't forgive me. And I did not notice even that I was saying, please don't forgive me. And people, they are looking at me. I see, why do you not to forgive you? Subhanallah. Now when I was telling you, don't forget me in my dua, my hyperlink system, you know, brought this 28 years ago story to me. La ilaha illallah. So don't forgive me? No, you corrected in your system. Don't forget me. Dr. Yasser and Brother Firas, all of you, pray for each other, inshallah. Jazakum Allah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum.